Hi, this is Anand Shirhatti with Verifsuda. Welcome back to the functional verification quality series. Last time when I had shared the introductory video, some of you, I think especially Rahul, had suggested that we could start off with common pitfalls in the planning, and I think RK had also suggested that if we could insert some text slides that would guide the audience better. So I think that feedback has been taken into consideration, and welcome to this video on 8 common pitfalls in verification planning. The first pitfall is thinking that we don't even need verification plan. I mean, that can be true if your project is very simple and it's a very short duration and very small team, you know, under and you don't have to support your design once you have taped it out. So if that is a nature of your project, maybe you can get away without having to write a verification plan. But if your project is complex and the verification cycles are longer and you have multiple engineers and teams participating in the process, you definitely need clarity and predictability to your verification execution. And that's the fundamental value your verification plan brings in. Beyond that, the value provided by verification plan compounds when you maintain it and use it as a baseline for doing any bug fixes verification or enhancements verification during the course of the lifetime of your design IP. The second pitfall that is generally takes place is waiting for the verification plan to be fully complete before starting any verification cycles. That type of approach can work provided all your design requirements are frozen and frozen for good. Now that's very unlikely to happen. So the optimal approach is focus on the width first and try to identify the scope of verification. Basically capture all your major sections and maybe capture the first level items within each of those sections, and that's a good enough starting point for your verification. What you have to essentially plan for is how can this verification plan adapt for the changes that are going to be coming in the future. So a combination of identifying all the major features and their first level items, and a strategy or a process to keep this verification plan adaptable to the changes is really a good starting point. A third pitfall is thinking that we need to write the verification plan to match our team size and schedule. No, your design complexity is not going to reduce just because you have a small team or you have a short schedule. So while writing verification plan, don't worry about the team size that is required or the schedule that is required to execute it. Do the justice to the complexity, think theoretically, enumerate all the possible cases that you can, and while executing the verification plan, we can always make a call based on the priorities and the current requirements of that particular project. Fourth pitfall is writing the verification plan in a Microsoft Word or Excel format. Although the initial verification plan can come from a verification lead or the feature owners, but a good chunk of it will be updated and enhanced by the verification engineers who will actually execute it. And by now we know that the verification plan has to be a living document, and for the changes to be effectively done by engineers, it has to look like a part of their regular workflow and almost like any other source code file. if it looks any different and they need to take extra steps to come out of their regular work environment to do the update to the verification plan to keep it current, then I would say good luck with that. Fifth pitfall is indexing the specification in verification plan to make it complete. Although there is some benefit to it, but the effort required to create and maintain it takes it away. So apart from that, the specifications are not really written for indexing them into your verification plan. What do I mean by that is the sections of specifications are not self-contained informations. So a particular feature may be spread out over several sections of a specification, in which case when you capture that particular feature in your verification plan, you may end up indexing several sections for that particular feature, leading to a lot of duplication and sort of dilution in the plan. And on the top of that, whenever the specifications do get updated, you will have to revise the section numbers for the existing items if they have changed. And it's a effort that is quite a low ROI. Instead, what you can do is maybe pick handful of major categories that are aligned to your design requirements and your verification goals and group the features into that. That would be more effective. Sixth pitfall is ignoring the microarchitecture specification and the implementation details. Most of the time, verification engineers tend to think that we are only focusing on a black box verification, and hence they invest their significant amount of energy only on the requirement specifications. And in this process, the microarchitecture specification and the nuances of implementation do not get the level of attention that they deserve. What we need to understand is some of the critical bugs hide in the intersection between your requirement specification and the microarchitecture specification. So we need to pay enough attention to it and capture it in the verification plan. Seventh pitfall is not having a way to enforce the rules. So you might have defined several rules about how the verification plan needs to be organized and how it needs to be updated, how a new test should be added. Now you have defined these several best practices and you cannot enforce them just by sending periodic emails. You need to invest in either building or buying some linting tools that can help you enforce these rules. And enforcing these rules ensures that the reliability of verification plans is not compromised, because once the reliability of the verification plans are compromised, the value of it falls very quick. Eighth pitfall is manually generating the metrics. Management needs several metrics from the verification plan to track the progress of verification. And sometimes these metrics are generated either manually or semi-automatically. This may be fine during the initial parts of the project, but towards the end, having access to a real-time data from your verification plan in the exact format that is required by the management will enable them to make the right decisions and monitor its effect and do any possible micro corrections in time. I would like to end this video with one of the famous quote on planning by General Dwight D. Eisenhower, which says, "In preparing for the battle, I have always found that plans are useless, but planning is indispensable." I think it holds very well for verification planning as well. The way I look at it is that It's not only the content of verification plan that by itself is important, but the process of its creation, its maintenance, and how it is utilized are also equally important to make it useful and successful. If you found this video useful, please share it with your friends and colleagues. Also, in the description of this video, I have put some of the links that can help you do a better verification planning. And don't forget to subscribe to VerifSudha channel for more of such insightful videos. Thank you.